Thanks so much for joining me. I'm Alicia Malone, and every Tuesday night since September the 1st, TCM has been airing an episode from the Mark Cousins docuseries, Women Make Film, A New Road Movie Through Cinema, and following it up with a selection of programming all based around female filmmakers. And tonight we are airing the 14th and final episode from the series. So to celebrate, I'm going to be hosting a panel where I'll be joined by a few of the filmmakers who have been with us throughout this journey, Mark Cousins, Wanuri Kahiu, and Kirsten Johnson. But before we get to that, we have a very special presentation given by the City of Los Angeles, who has proclaimed that today, December the 1st, is Women Make Film Day in the city. It is such a huge honor, and so I can't wait to see this virtual presentation given by Councilmember Mitch O'Farrell to TCM General Manager Pola Changnon. So I'll be back after this, but right now, here is Councilmember O'Farrell.
Hello, I'm Los Angeles City Councilmember Mitch O'Farrell, representing the 13th District here in Los Angeles. And that includes the neighborhoods of Hollywood, Echo Park, Silver Lake, just to name a few of the neighborhoods that are in my jurisdiction. I have the great honor and pleasure of advocating for production studios located in these areas, as well as the thousands of individuals in my district who make a living working in our signature film industry here in Los Angeles. I'm also a Turner Classic Movies film buff, and it is my pleasure to welcome Pola Changnon, General Manager of TCM, as I present an official city proclamation establishing December 1st as Women Make Film Day in the city of Los Angeles. Pola, it's so nice to talk with you today. This special recognition coincides with a much larger TCM event. Can you tell us more about that?
Oh, absolutely. Thank you so much. This is such a remarkable honor for TCM, and I'm really privileged to be able to represent the network today. And yes, we are really excited to share this remarkable programming event we've had on the network for the last 3+ months. It has been an expansive programming work of art, really. We started with Mark Cousins' 14-part documentary, Women Make Film. And for us, that was not only this remarkable look at the story of women making film through all the decades of filmmaking, but also it gave us an opportunity to program many more films around that documentary. So ultimately, we added 100 films to that incredible documentary, giving us a chance to really get our arms around this wide swath of filmmaking that is so often not heralded, not seen. And for us, that's an important part of what TCM does day in, day out. We're always, always trying to lift up those stories that aren't always understood or recognized. So for us, this has just been an incredible labor of love. And we're thrilled that here we are December 1st on the last night of our programming, being acknowledged this way by you and your organization just means a lot to us. Thank you.
My total pleasure. And Pola, I can't congratulate you and your team enough on this series, Women Make Film. You know, it's the 100-year anniversary of the 19th Amendment, which gave women the right to vote 100 years ago. And arguably, at that time, women filmmakers were more prominent than they are now,
yes,
since then. So I think there are perspectives we could weave into this as well. I've loved the series. I've managed to catch some of the films and seen a lot of the documentary that you spoke about. And the spectrum and the variety of the films has been amazing. I saw the film Machen in Uniform early on in the series, and that was a stunner and raw and real and authentic. And I think only a woman could have directed that film and that story. And this is early 1930s Germany. Phenomenal. And an eye-opener for me was Harlan County, USA. That documentary was stunning and amazing.
Yeah, Barbara Koppel, just thinking of that film, was so young at the time of making that film, and the effort it took and the time it took having to raise the money to sustain the production just adds a whole nother layer of appreciation for me. I think, you know, looking at the works in general, there were so many that were produced outside of sort of the Hollywood movie making culture. So you have to imagine that many other women had to borrow, scrimp, and save to tell these stories that were so important to them. And we're grateful. And as you say, yes, you know, while here we are, the centenary of women's right to vote, women were behind the cameras well before that right to vote. So I think it's just a sign of the indomitable spirit of filmmakers that they are pushing the boundaries these ways. And I was just thinking today, you know, in terms of the spectrum of film we're representing, it's Alice Guy Blaché at one end and Ava DuVernay at the other. It's this remarkable swath. And I just realized the poetry of their names kind of resonating with each other that made me feel really proud of what our team has done and the way that we have worked to encourage others to discover these treasures, because that's what they are. And I think, you know, so often in film, it's easy to kind of lean back on the expected canons of filmmakers. And we see our job as really shining a light and illuminating parts of our filmmaking history and culture that can connect with even more voices and more stories. So we're thrilled.
You've done it exquisitely. And I watched that interview with Barbara Koppel after the screening of the film, and the perspectives that she gave some 44 years later of being there, literally risking her life to tell this story. She exhibited great humility, but there were shots fired. She was dodging bullets to tell this story. And that demonstrates the power and the courage of women. And I think what better way, the way this was curated, the entire perspective of women of all backgrounds being able to tell their stories that really share the commonality of the human experience. And it's a very special lens when told by a woman, our mothers, our sisters, our grandmothers, the women in our lives. We as men, we know what that does for us. And to see that on such a beautiful stage through the Turner Classic Movies, I think was a very, very special moment in Turner Classic Movies history.
Agreed. I mean, I think it's something we're really proud of. Again, it took over a year plus in the planning. But to find the country kind of catching up with this conversation around women, again, behind the camera is really, it feels like a special moment. And I know we're starting to see some really great progress with women as directors for television, which is outstanding. And I think there is just an undeniable momentum behind this. And I hope that we're going to get to revisit this in the future and tell more stories about remarkable women making film.
What do you think the future holds for women in film from this launching?
Yeah, so that's a great question, Mitch. What do we feel right now at this time? I think it's really special that the industry has started to recognize that women do an amazing job directing. It's no surprise, 100 plus years of that demonstrated in our series. I think we're seeing some incredible numbers as far as television production, and that's outstanding. There's so many amazing opportunities right now, not only with the expected networks and cable networks, but also with all these streamers, and all they want is great content, you know? So I think that they're reaching out to some new voices in that way, which we will likely see in film increasingly as well. I think TV is an amazing proving ground for so many of these women. And it becomes a cycle. Women who have made theatrical movies want to come back to TV too. You can tell some different stories, but it's pretty thrilling. And I think that while right now we're looking sort of at the history of women who have made these films, I look forward to revisiting those women who continue to do so on our network, because they are making the classics of tomorrow.
So well said. And that's good news for all of your viewers. We all love TCM. And I believe this is a watershed moment in the journey that TCM has brought us all on all these years, and we're all better for it. So on that note, I'd like to present officially this certificate from the City of Los Angeles. And here I'm going to say a few words about it. This is from the entire City Council, and we're so proud to honor TCM for this great achievement. And it says in part, TCM Women Make Film Day in the City of Los Angeles. Let us be reminded of the context these films play in the greatest creative accomplishments, accomplishments that have greatly shaped and been shaped by Los Angeles and generations of its people and businesses. In many ways, the history of classic film is the history of Los Angeles and certainly the history of women. I'd like to present TCM with a resolution on behalf of the City of Los Angeles declaring Women Make Film Day in the City of Los Angeles. So here it is to you virtually. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, Mitch. It is a beautiful proclamation and it means so much to us here at TCM. And thank you for inviting us to celebrate Women Make Film in this way. We really appreciate it.
It's our honor. Congratulations. So glad we could spend this time together. And just pay tribute to your wonderful work there at TCM. Congratulations.
We're completely honored. So thank you.
It is such an honor that the City of Los Angeles has proclaimed that today is Women Make Film Day. So let's celebrate, firstly, starting with the man behind the docuseries, Mark Cousins. Hello.
Hi, Alicia. I'm happy to be here.
And Wanuri Kahiu, who introduced her film Rafiki on the series. Hi.
Hi, it's such a pleasure to join you again.
And Kirsten Johnson, you spoke about your film Camera Person, but you also have a very special guest with you today.
Yes, this is my father, Dick Johnson, and he is the star of a movie called Dick Johnson is Dead, even though he's not.
And Mark, I want to start with you because it's been so much fun to get to talk to you before each of the 14 episodes of your docuseries. But I know that this has been a long project for you. So what does it mean to have this honor given by the City of Los Angeles?
How fantastic. I nearly fell off my seat when I heard, Alicia, you know, you work away. We spent 5 years making this in this room and a few other rooms. And you just hope that people will see the love, the passion, that the passion for the subject matter for cinema will come out of the screen. And it seems to have done so.
Yeah, when you were beginning this project all those years ago, did you have any specific goals in mind, or was it more just about sharing the work of female filmmakers?
Yeah, it was mostly the latter. It was, you know, there were twin impulse, a love of cinema and a hatred of discrimination. You know, if you really love cinema, you want all cinema to be seen. If you hate discrimination and you notice that one type of filmmaker is being excluded, written out, sequestered, then you feel such a rage in your soul and you want to try and do something about that. And I had just a head full of great filmmakers that I felt were not being talked about enough. So that would get them back into the conversation.
And it's been such a pleasure to get to talk to female filmmakers about the craft of filmmaking, which I know sounds silly, but it is really rare. And Kirsten, I had so much fun talking to you about POV, close-ups, and dreams, and just getting into the nitty-gritty of filmmaking.
Oh, we did have such a good time. And I felt like that about the series in general. You know, what Mark is saying about people being written out of history was so flagrant when you see the series, because the quantity of extraordinary films that I had never heard of was kind of breaking my heart, and also thrilling to me. But, you know, I think it's so interesting when we look back at our own pasts and what inspired us to become filmmakers and sort of what we imagined was possible for ourselves. I think on the one hand, we want films to take us away into other worlds we've never imagined, but somehow we do need to see some form of something that connects us to ourselves to imagine that we are possible also. So the fact that certain peoples have been misrepresented terribly, like grossly, unjustly, with incredible amounts of racism in the way they've been depicted, or that people have been so marginalized that you can't even imagine they can be at the center of a story. I feel like, you know, this series is so like a balm. It was just like, oh, we've been here all along. And somehow, you know, people felt too uncomfortable with that and just kept, you know, pushing somebody to the side, pushing them to the side. And then this series says, look at the bounty that actually exists and the inspiration for so many young filmmakers to come.
And Wanuri, the conversation that we had about bodies and sex was honestly one of my favorites from the series, because not only did we get to talk about filmmaking, but it opened up the possibility to speak about a whole range of women's issues. And I know that something that's been really important to you and you've spoken about is the danger of the single story.
Absolutely. I just feel that there's so many ways to express our diverse humanity. And if we don't have multiple views or multiple lenses in which to kind of peek at what the possibilities of what we can be and awaken curiosity about what the movement, where we could move to, I think we're doing ourselves a really huge injustice, a huge disservice. So at any point that we can get into peek into different worlds, learn about different joy cultures, I think that we grow as people. And I'm so grateful to this for being part of the conversation of helping us learn and grow and truly push the boundaries of what is to what could be.
And Wanuri, it's not just about, you know, ticking a box to make sure you have inclusion. It's about telling the right story. And also for us who see ourselves reflected on screen a lot, it's exciting when we get to witness a variety of stories.
Absolutely. And there's something that I've been thinking very carefully about. And we are in a space where we have the freedom to imagine. But now we need to create more spaces where we have an imagination of freedom, so that we're seeing different types of freedoms, different types of ways of relating to the world. Because so many of the systems that we're living in are obviously not working. So if we could even begin to open up our imagination where we have other people who have been othered at the center of the conversation, at the center of the story. And not only does it help break down stereotypes, but for the people who have been othered for so long, it gives them reason to hope. Because if seeing is believing, and you see yourself in full glory, in joy, and in your abundance, then imagine what more we can imagine. Imagine what more we can hope for using just that as a simple platform to stand on. I think that that's the power of storytelling. That's why I'm so excited to be part of this conversation.
Even with your words, Wanuri, like that you say joy cultures, just that sparks a feeling of imagination and possibility and desire in us. And I think, you know, it's so critical in the way that we make films, the language that we use about making films. You know, when I named my film Camera Person, it sort of sparked this set of conversations about the language we use to describe cinema and how sort of set in one place that it has been instead of opened up to the many places it can be in.
And Mark, this was also something I was considering when watching your series, because it made me think about how we often use the language of filmmaking in a very gendered way. For example, you know, Hitchcockian, Wellesian.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, there are very few of those Ian words to relate to the great female directors. Muratovan, for example. Kira Muratova is one of the great filmmakers who ever lived, and yet hardly anybody uses that term, you know, and I love Kirsten's point about camera person. And I remember when I was studying in the English literature field, there was literature and then there was women's literature, as if it was a sideline or a marginal thing or something that you did at the weekend or in your spare time, you know, and they intended it right, you know. But in the series, we wanted to try and say the industry has been sexist and racist from the beginning, but the medium has no gender. The medium is genderless. And so it can, a shot and a cut does not have a gender. Men don't own it. And that's exciting to distinguish between the industry and the medium.
Yeah, it's so interesting what you say, Mark, about the medium itself is not gendered. And I would affirm that completely. And yet we get taught by other films. We get taught by the other films we see. And even the quality of a shot that we take, in so many ways, I was taught as a cinematographer to look at others with authority, as opposed to looking at others with curiosity, as opposed to imagining angles that the subjects themselves could teach me how to see. And my long experience in documentary, I always think of it as images are relationships. It's a back and forth between two humans. And yet the camera invests one of the people with more power. And whether the person who is being filmed takes their agency and engages in the relationship, knowing this imbalance of power affects how the shots function. So, this is a realm that I've been questioning myself throughout my career. But I think the medium is not gendered, but the medium does have implicit power. And how we engage with that power in some ways comes from the examples that we've had. And I think, that's why someone like Wanuri sort of remaking the form in her film, because she's seen from perspectives that have never been expressed before, is what I find so thrilling about discovering so many of the films in this series.
Yeah, and Wanuri, I know that one of the reasons you wanted to make Rafiki was that you didn't get to see a lot of African love stories on the big screen.
Yeah, there's been, I think for me, I think that it's great that we can talk about representation, and it's great that we can talk about diversity. But what it really tangibly means is that I grew up without seeing people like me fall in love. I grew up without me seeing people like me enjoy. I grew up without people like me being the best, most brilliant people that they can, because that wasn't an option for me. There wasn't a space for me to be seen or to be represented. So then how do I know I'm worthy of all of those things, of joy, of hope, of curiosity, if I don't see myself in those spaces? So diversity and inclusivity is personal. It's incredibly personal. And making Rafiki, I think for me, the biggest success of Rafiki was all those people who came to me after the film and said, that's the first time I've seen myself like that. That's the first time I've seen anybody, any version of queerness in that way. That's the first time I've seen queer people happy in that way, and queer people of color happy in that way. And that for me, I think, made it all the more worth it. But I think that now, as a result of that, I think it is important, and it is my service more than anything else, to continue to create spaces where we see people that haven't been seen before and create them in a way that reflects the world that we want to be in, not the world that we currently live in. Because we're still very tribalistic, whether we follow certain people on Twitter, whether we only subscribe to one point of view, we're becoming more and more divided, more and more binary. But there's no such thing as binary, because two things don't make a balance. We always need a fulcrum. So with that in mind, we always have to think of how many different other points of views there are in order to get to a deeper truth about humanity. And I think that's what the beauty of cinema is.
And Mark, to have a global perspective in your docuseries, I think is so vital, because it opens us up to not just being tribalistic, but getting to see and witness other cultures.
Yeah, and certain countries in the world have been far better at letting women get the means of production in their hands than others. Iran has been good. Sweden has been good. The old Soviet bloc was quite good in many ways, and they had other problems, obviously, but I think that where film industries have been real industries and businesses, women have been excluded even more so, perhaps, Hollywood and Bollywood being examples of that.
And Mark, you're about to get another honour from the European Film Academy, who is giving you the first ever Innovative Storytelling Award. And, you know, when you think about how welcomed this series has been, do you think perhaps it's more welcomed now than it may have been in the past?
Well, that's great if that's the case. It's quite humbling, of course, to get these things. And as we know as filmmakers, there's always this question of form, not only the content, but how do you shape your material in a way that surprises people, that excites people? So our approach was to decide to look at themes, you know, like close-ups and like bodies and like politics, and, you know, to try and tell it's a series of short stories rather than a novel. But I think that's hopefully interesting, and it made it exciting or creative to make, I think, you know. And it's gone all around the world. This series is showing in India, Russia, China, Brazil, all over Europe. So wow, if we can get movie lovers around the world to start to talk about Binka Zelyazkova from Bulgaria, to talk more about Safi Faye from Senegal, etc., etc. Wow.
You know, what was so wonderful about creating those categories of interrogating things was that you opened it up from the essentializing that usually happens to us. You know, it just becomes absurdist, these ways in which we attempt to group cinema by nation, by gender, and to, you know, to get to Wanuri's point, these large sort of monoliths that we heap cinema into are incredibly damaging because they don't allow the sort of extraordinary specificity and subjectivity of individuals. And once we get away from having to represent a nation that has been misrepresented or a people who has been misrepresented, then suddenly we can explore and sort of discover our own selves because, you know, to continue again what Wanuri is saying, like, we discover ourselves through cinema and we discover each other through cinema. But if we are caught in this sort of pattern of saying, yes, I'm a woman, but I'm not this, or, you know, those kind of patterns that the categorizations of cinema have asked of us, the ghettos that we've been asked to be in, we spend a lot of time defending ourselves out of those ghettos. And so I really was thrilled when I saw how you're structured, and it made me feel really excited and seen.
Yeah, Kirsten, because one of the ways we often categorize films is through the idea of a film canon, and these lists can be very instructional for people who are first coming into cinema to tell them what to watch and what not to watch.
And I think we don't even realize ourselves how we perpetuate these lists. You know, because it's like, you know, sometimes news, like people are going to the quickest, easiest, cheapest way to describe something. And I find, you know, when someone says, oh, give me a list of your 10 favorite films, I'll often sort of look in horror and realize I have listed 10 American films by men. And I'll say, like, how is that happening, right? Because it's sort of the quick and easy, it's what's on everybody's minds. And so that the cultures that are dominant on a global level, you know, whether it be through military dominance or capitalism, they're sort of constantly crushing all of our access to the specific extraordinary things that exist in other places in the world. So we all, I think, have to battle in ourselves to realize the ways in which we perpetuate these sort of monolithic representations of cinema.
Yeah, and Wanuri, being in Kenya, have you felt the dominance of Hollywood?
Oh my gosh, yes, I grew up on it. I knew more about the United States than I did about parts of my country, and definitely more than parts of my continent, which is it's shameful. And there's a lot of unlearning that I've had to do as a result. But truly, one of the things that I try and do is make sure that in any of the stories that I tell, where they have either people of color or women, that joy, hope, and courage is at the center of the stories. And it's really, really important to me to do that. So much so that I kind of created a test. I call it the Afro Bubblegum test. And it really asks three very basic questions that can that apply to any groups that have been othered. So if I want to judge whether or not a piece of work is Afro bubblegum, I ask, are two or more of the others in this film hopeless, desperate, or lost, sick or dying, in need of saving? And if the answer is no, then they don't. They're not an Afro bubblegum film, because I wanted to create language that centers joy and creates a space where joy and hope are part of their own genre. And that's why that test exists, to kind of just also keep me in line, because moving into a space like Hollywood, for a young filmmaker like myself, you are bombarded by many different projects. And so often the projects have nothing to do with you. And they don't even necessarily need your voice. So in order to center myself, I have to ask, are the people of color in this project, are they being treated with kindness? Do they have radical hope? And if the answer is no, then I cannot participate, because I do not want to perpetuate the same conversation about the same groupings of people in a negative way. I think that we can fundamentally be our own worst enemies just in the need to survive or in the need to succeed by other people's measures. We can cut ourselves off in this very same way. So it became important for me to figure out ways of being able to define for myself what kind of work I want to do. And that has been very helpful.
And how have you found reception to that as you've begun to work in Hollywood?
You'd be surprised. I think there's the idea of joy is such a galvanizing, strong feeling. People, we all want it. And I am confident that we are better able to relate through joy than through suffering. So often suffering creates a them and an us, but joy is inclusive and brings us together. And I think that there's more and more people who recognize that and who are on this mission to create joyful, hopeful work. And I am part of that mission.
Yeah, and I think, Kirsten, your work also has this sense of joy to it. We can see your father, Dick Johnson, there sitting next to you, and he has such an expression of joy on his face, and that film is so full of joy. So do you think joy can be radical when we're talking about difficult subjects or the way that people have been othered?
Well, you know, this is a process. Being human is this process in which we learn about our own blind spots and we learn about the ways in which we've been complicit in things. And when I made Camera Person, which was a film in which I went back and looked at footage that I had shot over all of these years, you know, what you're saying, Wanuri, about finding joy was difficult. I realized that I had filmed people in situations of duress over and over again. And it became something really critical for me to engage with what that was about, why we were only filming suffering. And the one moment that is funny in Camera Person is a moment in which we are with a Bosnian grandmother who, you know, the team is sort of pressing her to speak about the violence that her family experienced during the genocide, and she does not want to. And I finally could not contain myself any longer as a camera person. And I had been admiring her extraordinary outfit the whole time of filming her. And I said to her, you know, I just want to change the subject for a moment. Have you always been such a great dresser? And she said, yes. And it is the moment where a person who is only seen as a victim is suddenly seen in a different way. And her joy at being recognized as someone who is a fabulous dresser was so extraordinary that you'd laugh out loud. And having, you know, created, you know, that moment in the center of a film that's about so much suffering, part of that taught me that I needed to make my next film with a lot more joy in it. So I'm absolutely on board with the Afro bubblegum test, and I will be applying it to all my future films. But you know, I'm not making another film that's not funny. Like I am committed to joy and committed to humor moving forward.
And Mark, I think you're also committed to joy as well, because at the very beginning of the docuseries, it says, feel free to be frustrated that all of these names have been overlooked, but also feel free to be delighted by the medium of cinema. And I think that delight is a thread that runs through most of your films.
Yeah, I always feel I come alive when I watch a movie. When I'm sitting in a cinema, I feel as if I'm sitting in winter looking at summer. The luminosity of the screen, I actually think, I always pretend that you can get vitamin D from the screen. It makes you feel alive. I have to say, Kirsten, I laughed at the, you know, that when you sneeze off camera, in camera person, that always makes me laugh. So that's another funny moment.
Ooh, okay, two laughs.
Yeah. going to the cinema is an act of optimism. Making a film is sort of an act of optimism because it's reaching beyond yourself. You know, it's standing outside yourself in some way into a universal field of experience or aspiration, or the use the lovely word joy again, you know. So it's definitely a universalization of something. And to reach out is an act of solidarity and therefore innately optimistic.
And Mark, are you optimistic about the future of women making films, given the amount of emotion you've seen for your series?
It's a lot better than it was 5 years ago, but it's still got a long way to go. You know, it's really interesting things happening in Ethiopia, for example, but there's a long way to go still, as we know.
Yeah, Wanuri, what's been your experience when you've had these kind of conversations? You said that people are starting to be receptive to it, but do you think there's still a long road ahead?
Yes, definitely. I think that one of the things that we need is to stop offering mentorship to women and just start offering them jobs. We will learn on the job. We will learn on the job just like men do. You know what I mean? I think that there's spaces for that to happen. And there's spaces for more filmmakers to stand up and vouch for other filmmakers, because that's how it's happened in the past. Steven Spielberg has managed to get many filmmakers to become really well-considered, to get them their first films, but just being an executive producer on their work. There's so many ways that we can continue to support female filmmakers and also challenge audiences. It's not a passive thing, especially in this day and age where data is king. So if the audience feels that they are deserving of watching films made by women, with women at the center of them, then they need to buy the tickets, or they need to watch them on their streaming channels, and they need to press like, so that that data is used as evidence for other filmmakers to come through. Because so far the data is against us. The data says people don't want to watch female films, or people, that's what's used as a sort of economic censorship when women are trying to make their next films. So I challenge not only filmmakers to support women, but for audiences to support the kind of films they want to see. And they don't have to be great. Audiences don't even have to like the films. They just have to watch them so that they can just do it for the data, because that's the thing that's kind of leading the charge. So that's my rallying call, is do it for the data.
Do it for the data.
Well, I mean, you know, that's the thing that you're acknowledging, Wanuri, is that we're caught within systems. And, you know, I've made these two films, Camera Person and Dick Johnson Is Dead, and people say, we've never seen a film like this before, as a wonderful compliment, and I'm thrilled to receive it. But in the making of these films, so often people will say, well, I don't understand what you're making. It doesn't make any sense to me. I've never seen anything like this before. So that you sort of experience these obstacles. And I remember, you know, I've been in this industry 30 years. I remember trying to get a narrative feature made in 2006 that had all of its main protagonists were people of color, and the central person was a woman. And financiers saying to me, there are no actors who can fill these roles. No audience will want to see this. We have no proof that anyone would want to see a film like this. And I didn't believe them, and yet I was daunted by the fact that they told me at every step of the way, you will face an obstacle. And at that same time, I was with Victoria Mahoney, who was also trying to get a film made with all people of color at the center of it. And she was undaunted because, like you, Wanuri, she was like, this is me and there is no me on the screen. I'm going to fight for it. It took her 10 years to finance her first film. And, you know, during that time, I went off and shot other documentaries because we knew together that it was going to take her 10 years to do that. And it would have taken me 10 years to do it. And so I think we shouldn't be naive about the obstacles that exist. But I think we have to encourage each other to take risks. And like you say, encourage the audience to take risks and also treat the audience with the sophistication they have. People love to see new things they've never seen before. People love it.
Yeah. And Wanuri, have you found a community of women or men that have been very supportive in your mission?
Oh, absolutely. I think that the world is changing. I mean, even just the time and moment that we live in where the next vice president is a woman of color, I think that there is space to create new dimensions, new worlds, new points of views, and imagine the stories that will come based off of that knowledge. Imagine the stories that are coming now that there is a reality of a woman of color being the vice president in America, where now imagination can fly. Now we have even more shoulders to stand on so that we can reach further with the stories that we tell. I think that it's a domino effect. And for every new thing we learn, we want to learn more. And I'm so encouraged by the audiences and so encouraged by the people who are excited about involving people like me in their art.
Well, since we've spoken, both you, Wanuri, and you, Kirsten, have had incredible momentum with your career. Wanuri, it's been announced that you're going to be adapting the best-selling young adult novel On the Come Up. So what has your experience been like since Rafiki?
It's been a roller coaster. I have to say that the whole notion that it takes 10 years to be an overnight success, I am a product of it. And as hard as I've worked through my career, I'm only beginning to, 12 years in, I'm only beginning to see the success of it and the possibilities of it. And that's just a testament to the need of being stubborn, the need to dig your heels in, and the need to keep creating. I'm so grateful for it.
And Kirsten, I definitely recommend that everyone watch Dick Johnson is Dead on Netflix because it's exactly the kind of celebration of life I think we all need right now. And, you know, this film is very different to your previous movie, Camera Person, plus you're releasing it during a pandemic. So what has that experience been like for you?
It's so ironic that, you know, I spent 3.5 years making this film with my father that was an attempt to understand how cinema can engage with the unexpected. And then boom, the pandemic hit us and I didn't see it coming like so many of the rest of us. You know, I think only the epidemiologists saw it coming. And I cannot tell you how profound it is to be speaking about this film in this moment because we are all in this shared territory of anticipatory grief. You know, some of us have already lost people. Some of us are afraid of losing people. Some of us wish to hug and to touch the people we love most. We cannot. And that, you know, when a person has dementia, that anticipatory grief of, you know, so I've lost them already. No, I haven't. They're still there. I've lost them. That back and forth is very much what's happening to all of us right now. And, you know, Mark is all about this. Cinema is time itself. And this moment in time, this moment in history that we're in, we don't understand the shape of it yet. We don't know how long it will last. We don't know when this moment will end. But I think what we all know is that cinema has taught us that our relationship to time as humans is not just chronological, There are not just beginnings and endings that are clear. Things loop around, and there's a way in which the impossible has become possible all over the globe. We have been united in ways we never imagined possible. And we're also, once again, seeing the systemic injustice and difference of people's experience. And the way that some people's deaths are fought against and some people's deaths go unacknowledged. So, you know, I think that we are in a fight for our lives, you know, and I, while I affirm the joy that we are discussing, I also, because, you know, I go serious, also, we have to understand, what are people afraid of? What do they resist when people like us come on the scene and they say, hey, we've never seen you be here before. We don't really want you. Can you make this film like this other film we've seen before? What is that about? Understanding what the resistance and violence against newness is about, I think, is fundamental to our survival as humans.
Yeah, and Mark, I know you experienced a lot of questions when you were putting together the financing for Women Make Film. People didn't really understand what you were doing.
Yeah, and we got zero funding for it, not a penny, not a dollar, you know, over five and a half years. But we thought, you know, I really identify with what you say, Wanuri, about this sort of unstoppability of the creative process. You know, you can't help yourself almost. And so we just kept going, you know, and under lockdown. I also really agree, Kirsten, what you say about time. It feels to me that under the COVID crisis, time stopped, but also stretched like mozzarella or something, you know. And so under that time of enforced confinement, I've completed three films just because it keeps me alive, it keeps me alert, it keeps the centrifugal, the outwardly directed imagination going.
Wow, that's amazing. Three films. And so for you, Mark, is it all about the creative process? Are you invested in how it's received after that?
Yeah, I mean, I remember David Lynch once said to me, there's the donut and there's the hole, and the donut is the work and the hole is what people say about the work. So, you know, I love the making process, and the rest of it, you know, is sort of away from me in a way. So I don't really bother too much about the reaction. You just want to do as good a piece of work as you can, and then really question yourself. Can I improve? Can I get even better? Can I evolve my voice to be more resonant and articulate as a filmmaker?
And Wanuri, what keeps you going through all of the obstacles that you faced in your career?
I think the ability to just live in different worlds through different projects, the ability to just dive into a new space and that is either completely unfamiliar or reassuringly familiar. And the knowledge that as I create, whatever I cry or laugh about as I'm creating, I know that other people will resonate in the very same way. So there's something about being joined through time from the moment that I'm creating to the years forward in the future when the work that I created all those years ago is seen. And we're linked through this time in this period where the work is seen and the emotion is felt. The very same emotion I was creating is felt by an audience member 5, 6, 10 years down the line, and we're linked through time in that moment. Just the idea of that keeps me going. Just the idea of creation and building worlds and making the kind of utopia through the work that we want to participate in is enough. It's complete. And that's what keeps me going.
Yeah, and you know, one of the great joys of being a film lover is the shared experience inside a cinema, which we can't have right now. So Kirsten, is it all about the creative process for you as well? And did you have any qualms about releasing a film right now when people can't see it in a cinema?
Well, you know, when you speak of utopia, the fact that people can live forever in movies, you know, that we meet dead people through films. And we love, we fall in love with people in films, and they help us imagine our own futures was so much of the inspiration for Dick Johnson is dead. And I didn't care when it came out, you know, like Mark in a certain way. It was an act of defiance and resistance against death on behalf of my father. I wanted to use a movie to hold him together, even as dementia was pulling him apart. And we did that in real time while it was happening. And now, you know, that it's coming out into the world, like Wanuri so beautifully said, we are joined by other people. We're in solidarity with other people who are just like going through it. And somehow the movie gives us a space to connect and relate to each other. An audience member helps me see a movie in a whole different way. My own movie helps me understand myself in all new ways. So this ongoing relationship of cinema is part of what keeps me going. It is also just the creative joy and pleasure, like Mark's saying, of just like, you just get into it and then magical things happen. You know, you sort of work on something and then how did that happen? It's so beyond explicable, and the rush of the magical things that happen is really euphoric. And I think we feel that in this series, Mark, your euphoria at making certain discoveries and connections and seeing things loop around. And so we share as audience this sort of just like we can't stop ourselves. You know, I think often with your series, it's like, wow, it's that long. And then you're like, oh, I want it to keep going. Don't stop, you know? And so I really can't recommend this series enough to people and all of Mark's series, because I think as an audience member, it shares with you the passion of being a creator.
It's so true. And, you know, this series is not pretentious at all. There's no gate you need to go through, no gatekeeper. You don't have to prove how many films you've seen or not in order to enjoy it. It really is just about the joy of discovery. And that's what I've loved, is seeing how many viewers have kept lists about all the films that they want to see after watching the series, and they're all made by women. So now I'm going to ask you all a tough question, because, you know, we have this great honor from the city of Los Angeles with Women Make Film Day. The conversation has definitely started, but Mark, beginning with you, where would you like to see this conversation going in the future?
You know, if in 5 years' time we don't talk about Binka Zelyaskova, if we don't talk about Kira Muratova, if we don't talk about Kinyo Tanaka, if we don't talk about these great filmmakers in the same breath that we talk about Coppola and Billy Wilder, we have failed.
Yes, absolutely. Wanuri, what about you? Where would you like to see this conversation going moving forward?
I am excited to be part of a future where we're not defined by these arbitrary numbers about who should see, can't see, will see the work that we create, but know that we are putting out into the world these creations of art that are representative of a holistic human experience, that we are better equipped to move into the future knowing that we have heard so many different voices that can advise or guide or even chastise if necessary, and lead us into a different future, a future that we haven't even begun to imagine. And that is impossible without the creation and the inclusion of more women's films.
I love that. Kirsten, what would you say?
Oh, why would I say anything more after the... You two nailed it, you know. Honestly, I love the enthusiasm that both of you express. And it's just so funny because I'm like maximalist, optimist, like all of these things. And yet I am also here saying we are in a fight for our lives. The data is against us. Machines, corporations, nations wish to crush our subjectivity, and not just women's. They are trying to crush us as humans, and we are in a battle for our lives. And I think cinema is a form of resistance, and joy is resistance. And I think that's what we have to sort of armor ourselves with, but also open ourselves with, open our hearts with, and share our open hearts in this battle of resistance.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, the fight continues. And I have to say that personally, for me, this has been the most fulfilling job that I have ever done. The conversation has started, but I'd like to encourage everyone out there to keep the conversation going and to watch Mark's film. And Mark Cousins, thank you so much for all of the work you do, not only about women, but about film history itself.
Thank you. What a pleasure.
And Wanuri Kahiu, I cannot wait to see what you do in the future. Here's to joy being a revolution.
Amen. Do it for the data.
And Kirsten Johnson, it is such a pleasure to speak with you again. I have to say, I really appreciate the experimental nature of your films, and I hope you're making another film right now.
Oh, yes, I am. And, you know, I think that's the thing about cinema. It is relationships across time and space, which is what we've managed to do with these set of conversations about this series. And we're reaching out, you know, through these little screens to all of the audience, the person who is sitting there watching this, who will imagine yourself anew when you see a film made by someone else. So I'm so honored to be in this conversation with all of you. And it encourages me.
Well, I would like to thank the City of Los Angeles for making today Women Make Film Day. A big thank you to Councilmember Mitch O'Farrell, to TCM General Manager Pola Changnon. Also a big thank you to my Women Make Film co-host, Jacqueline Stewart, who unfortunately couldn't be with us today. But thank you so much for all the hard work you did throughout this series. And a big thank you to Mark Cousins, Wanuri Kahiu, and Kirsten Johnson. I'm Alicia Malone, and I'll see you on TCM.